Bonjour, Monsieur Dam. And welcome to our presentation about SpeakAll and SpeakMore, two research-based iPad applications for augmentative and alternative communication in severe autism. My name is Oliver Wendt. I'm assistant professor of speech, language and hearing sciences at Purdue University. And joining me this morning is my colleague, Dr. Mike Zentner, who is entrepreneur in residence and research scientist at Purdue as well. And the two of us are co-founders of a young startup company by the name of Speak Modalities that we have implemented to push our applications from Purdue University onto the marketplace. Our presentation this morning will focus on minimally verbal children with severe autism. Autism, by definition, includes a delay in or lack of the development of spoken language. It is actually estimated that up to 66% of the children on the autism spectrum do not develop communicative speech, and then they do not have sufficient natural speech or language to meet their daily communication needs. Thus, they become candidates for intervention in an area that we call augmentative and alternative communication, or AAC for short. AAC in autism includes strategies such as communicating via manual signs and gestures, via pictographic symbol systems and sets such as the picture exchange communication system, which is probably the most popular low-tech AAC strategy for children with severe autism. With recent advances in high technology, we see that more and more AAC interventions are using so-called speech-generating devices that produce synthetic or digitized speech. They can come in different forms. Dedicated devices means the electronic communication aid is specifically manufactured for communication purposes only. And most recently, with all the energy and efforts going into applications and tablet development, more and more tablets with AAC apps are being used for AAC interventions. As we have heard many times during the course of this conference, ideally we would like to see that caretakers and practitioners use more evidence-based approaches and use speech and language learning devices and applications that have some research backing and research support. And this is where our mission lies at the university and through our startup company. Our first application is called SpeakAll, and SpeakAll differentiates itself from the competition through very important features. First of all, many AAC apps often have too much sensory stimulation for the child with severe autism, have too many bells and whistles, more than the child with severe autism can handle, and then there is often the risk that the child starts self-stimulating on the device, hitting all the types of functions and different buttons that are out there without using the device in a more meaningful, functional way. SpeakAll purposefully reduces sensory processing difficulties and tries to eliminate cognitive overload and sensory overload. SpeakAll allows to teach an early symbol vocabulary up to the point that the learner can create simple sentences. It also allows a very easy transition from low-tech strategies such as the picture exchange communication system to infusing devices such as tablets, and it can easily be customized to each child's specific needs. SpeakAll is very easy to implement and is very parent-friendly so that parents can continue the intervention efforts of therapists and school teachers that are starting SpeakAll intervention in the schools and clinics. And at the university, we have been engaged in collecting the research evidence to make sure that this truly produces an effect. We have behavioral as well as neurophysiological data to support this application. As far as behavioral evidence is concerned, we have conducted three experiments so far. In the first experiment, we wanted to make sure that the intervention effects that we were seeing in the lab extend to school classrooms and clinical settings. In the second experiment, we were asking, are there also generalization results? Once we use SpeakAll to teach a certain set of stimuli, does the newly learned skill generalize over to previously untrained items? And we wanted to do this with another cohort of a little older participant cohort, including adolescents and young adults, because many of the AAC apps focus on children and are not necessarily made for older adolescents and adults. And currently we are finishing up on another study where parents are learning to be interventionists for their child and are taking over the intervention that usually therapists and teachers would do in the classroom. In all of these experiments, we looked at two major outcomes. First, the major goal of every AAC intervention is always to establish functional communication and making sure that the child has a way to clearly indicate what are his or her basic wants and needs. The second outcome that we are always looking at is natural speech production. And this is important because there is a myth out there that AAC prevents natural speech. Many caretakers and parents are concerned, once I go down this route, once I start an AAC intervention, my child will never start using his or her own natural voice. So that is why monitoring word approximations and tracking down the number of full word utterances is important to us. As far as the methodology is concerned, we used a single subject experimental design approach. Single subject experiments rank very high on evidence hierarchies in augmentative and alternative communication and are an excellent way to repeatedly measure pre- and post-treatment performance in a small sample of individuals. It is important to understand that in AAC intervention, it's just not sufficient to put a device or a tablet with an app in front of the child, you also have to have the right intervention approach or instructional approach to see any type of intervention effect, to see increases in communication, speech, and language skills. We used a modified protocol of the picture exchange communication system because that is already evidence-based, and we could adapt that to infusing an iPad. So what you would usually do with picture exchanges, you would now do that by activating symbols on your tablet device. And with this protocol, we systematically moved young learners with severe autism from one symbol activations over to learning different symbols, over to constructing simple sentences. And at this point, we did a very important modification to the existing PECS protocol. It was important to us, once children had learned to construct simple sentences, that they would make an attempt to read aloud the sentence together with the trainer on the tablet device. So we added more rigorous speech elicitation, as we will later see in the data. This had an effect in getting the child to be better in terms of developing their own natural speech and, in the end. The last phase is also quite critical because here the child learns to, without much prompting, more spontaneously answer the question, what do you want, and more spontaneously request snacks or foods or whatever is being taught on their own. I'm going to show you just some brief video clips for participants before and after intervention. The first video clip will show one young girl and one young boy before intervention started. You will see the typical autistic symptoms, including stereotypical behaviors, hand flapping, vocal stimming, aberrant speech and language, and their prelinguistic communication repertoires consist primarily of reaching and grabbing for items. Let's see.
Look what I have. See, you want the toothpaste.
Then the following video clips show the intervention effects. Let me see if I can pull that slide up. You may need to help me here.
Yeah.
No, this one. This one. All right. Now we got it.
turn the symbols.
Toothpaste.
Fruit. Yum. Can you say it, David?
I want toothpaste.
Excellent. Before.
Checks.
Yeah, excellent. This is what I
said. I want Pringles.
Pringles. I want Pringles.
How do you ask?
I want a big candy cane.
You want your big candy cane? There's your big candy cane.
And as you could see at the very end, whenever children get to this level, that they are starting to use their own natural speech, we're trying to fade out the iPad, taking away that fear that the child will always depend on iPad-based intervention, which isn't true. You can get them to the point that they are starting to use their own voice, and then you can continue with regular speech and language therapy. These are the research results, an example from the parent-implemented intervention study. First, we have the effects on requesting skills. This is intervention. Let me see if I can get my pointer on. These are the intervention sessions tracked over time, and these are the increases in requesting skills. We have three participants, Sally, Leo, and Stan. Sally was the young girl that you saw in the video clip. And you can see as soon as intervention starts, this is pre-treatment. Requesting skills are close to zero, non-existent. As soon as intervention starts, they all immediately acquire this ability to request via the iPad. And then with each new phase, in the beginning, they have to learn that new phase, but eventually they get up to speed and master those phases. And for two of the three participants, we were able to demonstrate that they were that they could fade out the iPad and do requesting with their own natural voice. The effects on speech production vary a little bit more. Like I said, two participants actually acquired their own natural speech, had their own natural voice. The third participant got to that level of functional communication but did not become vocal or verbal. And this could be because this individual has a dual diagnosis of both Down syndrome and autism, indicating a larger level of cognitive impairment. We also conducted data on neurophysiological changes in the brains of those individuals that underwent intervention. And we used a technique that is called the quantitative electroencephalogram, or QEEG. The QEEG creates a brain map, and these brain maps show changes in electrical brain activity before and after intervention. Here we're seeing one of those participants before intervention took place with SpeakAll. And the red areas are aberrant brain activity. There's too much electrical impulses going through the autistic brain. The blue areas indicate there's not enough electrical activity. The brain is understimulated and not well functioning. And the green areas are normal brain functioning. Over the course of intervention, and we provide intervention on average 2 to 3 days a week, often 2 sessions on 1 day. After treatment with this rigorous program, we can see that there's quite some improvement. A lot of these red areas turn over into green, more normalized areas of brain functioning. SpeakAll is focused on establishing functional communication and enhancing natural speech production. And once an initial symbol vocabulary is being taught, it is very important to go beyond requesting and labeling and into teaching more advanced language. And this is what SpeakMore accomplishes through teaching advanced language concepts, increasing vocabulary, and targeting generalization skills, which are often a very difficult issue in learners on the autism spectrum. SpeakMore accomplishes that by implementing an evidence-based strategy called matrix training. And this slide shows how that works. In matrix training, the child learns to combine two semantic categories that can be whatever is developmentally appropriate. Often we start out with teaching actions and objects. We could then move on to adjectives and objects, or to agents and actions. The app models a limited set of combinations, the child learns that drop can be combined with cup, that drop can be combined with spoon, and so forth. And then it's not too much of a cognitive leap for the individual to understand, oh, I can combine drop with ball, with cup, and take out with ball. And then the app comes in and tests them for generalization to newly untrained exemplars. So by teaching just a limited set of six actions and six objects and their combinations, you in the end get 36 new utterances that are making it into the communicative repertoire of the child, very efficiently increasing their vocabularies. This is what SpeakMore looks in practice. You can see a screenshot here. These are the different actions, these are the objects, and here's a video stimulus that is provided. Constant prompting keeps the child engaged in these activities. Reinforcement is provided through animated but simple graphics that appeal to the visual strengths of these learners, and the game-based format keeps these individuals motivated. A brief video clip what SpeakMore intervention looks like. We will see an 11-year-old boy with severe autism. In the beginning, he doesn't have much speech and language. He then learns the PECS approach, learns the speech-generating device. You won't see that on the video clip, but now we are at a point with him where we're working on advanced language skills, and like I said before, it's always important to us that he's also trying to say those newly learned words with his own natural voice. Oops.
Say it?
One.
Two.
Go.
Go. Perfect. Can you say it?
One.
Point two.
Go.
You are correct.
Cup. That's right.
What is Sarah doing?
One.
Ball. You are correct.
Ball.
What is Sarah doing?
Drop. What is the word?
Yeah.
Cup.
Cup. You are correct.
We have collected proof of concept data for two individuals so far. These are the two individuals, and Andy, who you saw in the video clip. And the upper strand of data always shows how quickly they learn the combinations that are taught through the app, and the lower strand of data always tells you how quickly they then generalize these newly learned skills to new exemplars, new items. In conclusion, we feel that taking such a research approach is key to app development in AAC for autism. It tells us a lot about what are the important features of apps, and how can we fine-tune these interfaces to the learning characteristics of this population. It is important to incorporate the right instructional intervention approach and not just provide a tablet with an app, and we hope to do that through our app development. We have shown that through our research, the speak apps can actually enhance natural speech development, and this refutes the myth that AAC prevents speech. And very importantly, parents can actually be part of speak intervention, and they can continue and maximize the benefits of AAC interventions that are started in school and clinical settings. We recommend, however, that whenever possible, a professional, a trained AAC interventionist is there to supervise and guide the parents. I'd like to quickly acknowledge our sponsors for all the research, and we are particularly thankful to all the families who agreed to participate in our research. This is our contact information. We have a variety of resources out there on the internet. In particular, I like for you to go to our Facebook site and help us spread the word. As more people like us, as better it helps us to get the news out. We are a small startup. We have no marketing budget. We have no full-time employees, and we would like to make this known to an audience as broad as possible. I don't know if you have time to take questions,
we have just a moment for questions. We do. Okay?
Over there.
Please.
Oliver, I'm just wondering what you see as the advantage of this app is, if it must be used by someone with expertise in speech communication.
Later on, when it comes to decisions, what symbols to teach, it is good if someone has expertise in what the trajectory of normal language development is, so that they would tell the parent or whoever wants to continue the intervention, now you should be teaching this type of classes. Now you should be teaching agents and actions. Now it's time to move into adjectives. Now it's time to actually do actions and objects. There's a certain developmental trajectory to normal language development, and it is best if that is guided by a professional who knows what to target at what specific point in time to make sure the child doesn't get frustrated with a task that is too difficult or doesn't make enough progress because you are still keeping it too easy. So in a nutshell, would be my response. Maybe one more quickly.
Hi, I was particularly impressed in your first with Speak All that you had a third subject that didn't show.
That's right.
What do you have the EEG data for that individual? Because I think that would be extremely informative as well.
Not at this point. This
do you plan to get that?
We do plan to get that. Yes.
Right. Because I'm always very skeptical of these kind of presentations when they only show the successes, because I think it's very instructive to show the ones that don't get.
And
where you intend.
My expectation is that once we pull the EEG from this individual, it will show a much higher degree of brain abnormality and brain impairment, because like I said, he has a dual diagnosis of both Down syndrome and autism, and on cognitive tests, he comes out as very severely
challenged. Might have dyspraxia, though.
You know.
It may not be any cognitive impairment. Could be a motor impairment, not able to produce speech.
From the motor speech perspective.
Right.
Motorically, just with his hands, he does do very well so far. But yeah, the neurophysiological data would be going in that direction, that maybe we can predict intervention outcomes a little bit better if we know what the profiles are that are correlated with different intervention outcomes. Yep, very good point. All right, thank you very much. I'm going to move on to the next.
Thank you. Thank you so much.